Welcome in this video related to the test performance to the organization and more specifically the importance of the statistical analysis when designing the test performance studies, but also when analyzing the data. This first video of the series will be focused on introducing this importance and explaining how it can help you to design a proper sample panel. Do we trust in diagnostic results? In fact, you will say yes. If the laboratory is accredited, it fulfills all the requirements, training, infrastructure, traceability, control. Well, in fact, in Europe, diagnostic laboratories have to be ISO 17025 accredited. But behind this, there is a very important baseline also. This baseline is also if the test has been properly evaluated, either only internally or through test performance study, including several laboratories. And we will have a focus on this, because in fact, TPS need proper design and data interpretation, and that will be the heart of these videos. So, what does mean a test performance study? In fact, we want to evaluate the performance characteristics of one or several tests. And ideally, we would like to test to evaluate the performance on the whole population of laboratories, as you can see here. But practically, you cannot include any testing laboratory in your evaluation. So you will work only on a subsample of them. Some of them only will be the participants, which means that you create a small bias. This is fairly the same for the samples, the strains, the isolates of the pathogens you want to evaluate the test. In this case, you only analyze not all the isolates, but only some of the isolates, the samples that will be included in the test performance study. What is key is that the TPS aims to evaluate the performance criteria based on a subset of laboratories and a subset of sample. It's impossible to evaluate the whole population, so we take a small part of it and we need to extrapolate the results to all laboratories, which means that we'll estimate this performance criteria, which is particularly important because in estimation, you always have a margin of error. And immediately you have the key question, which subset will I use? That's something that has been addressed here. Because what you need for a TPS is to generate an appropriate amount of data to evaluate this performance characteristic or criteria of the test. And generating enough data is relying on two key elements. The number and type of samples that you include in your sample panel, and the number of laboratories when you carry out this TPS, how many laboratories will participate. And there you are between two contradictory forces. Indeed, if you have the view of statisticians, they would always suggest to add more and more samples, more and more laboratories. The more you have, the higher the chance to be close and to have a panel representative of the full population. On the other hand, if you are a laboratory or test performance study organizer, you cannot use many samples or include too many laboratories because you have a limited amount of resource. So that's why you need to have like a balance between the statistical relevance and the representativity of your subset compared to the available resources. So for that, we have to think, what are the performance criteria that will be addressed or that needs to be evaluated? So the purpose is to evaluate several performance characteristics of the test. The first group of characteristics are classical ones you know about. It's diagnostic specificity, diagnostic sensitivity. And what we will propose in this series of video is to expand these two calculations with other criteria that can give you a good overview of the performance of the test, always based on the metrics Using small true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative. And to calculate this group of performance criteria, we can rely on the presence in the sample panel of non-infested sample and of infested sample. On the other hand, another very important characteristic of a test is the analytical sensitivity. What is the limit of detection? And that's why, in the majority of the case, we have to recommend the use of diluted infested sample with serial dilution in order to evaluate the limits of detection of the test. And finally, the third group of important criteria are the repeatability and reproducibility. And in that case, we can use all the samples from the test, non-infested, infested, and diluted infested one, provided they have been sent to the laboratories at least in duplicate to evaluate the repeatability, and that the same set of sample has been sent to all the participants to evaluate the reproducibility between laboratories. In the frame of the Valid Test project, what we have proposed, we propose an indicative sample panel for TPS, and it corresponds to 25 samples. You can see here in the table, this panel is first composed of healthy samples. We propose to have three healthy samples and at least with two replicates for each of them. An important point is that this sample can contain or be infested by a closely related target. So you can evaluate if you don't have cross detection. And these three samples must be independent from each other. For the infected sample, with the red point here, we recommend two biological samples also in two replicates. Ideally, a sample with quite low concentration, close to the expected limit of detection, and another one with a medium concentration. Again, independent sample from each other. And the third group of sample, this is the serial dilution. Here, we can recommend to use one sample and to use five dilution points. These five dilution points are important because we will be able to build a model to evaluate the limit of detection of the test. And here, we recommend also to use triplicates in order to evaluate the limit of detection. And this sample must be different from the two infected ones. As you can see here in this proposed panel, there is a strong focus on analytical sensitivity. 15 out of 25 samples are for analytical sensitivity. So, this is a recommendation, but it is clear that you may need to adapt the sample panel composition depending on the intended use of the test and its potential weaknesses that you have identified previously. For example, you have a key question on the inclusivity for the analytical specificity. In that case, you can use more infested samples and maybe use less sample to evaluate the analytical sensitivity because you feel that is not a key weakness of the test. You can have also other questions or you can fear more difficulties related to the exclusivity. In that case, you can use more sample with closely related targets in order to evaluate this specific criteria. So this sample panel needs to be adapted depending on the intended use of the test and what you feel are the most important criteria to evaluate. So, the sample panel that we will use in these different videos to illustrate the guidelines that we have set and the statistical analysis of the result is this one. It is a sample panel that has been used with the aim of detecting viruses. And in our case, we will take two tests that we will compare on 22 samples with a series of participating laboratories. As you can see here, there is, for this sample panel, a focus on exclusivity. Indeed, we have much more healthy sample, but infected by a closely related target, because this was a potential weakness of the test that the organizer wanted to evaluate through the TPS. As a consequence, we have the diluted sample, as you can see there, all which are in five dilution points as recommended, but in duplicates. So this illustrates the flexibility that there is in the panel setting.
So this is for the panel of sample, but what about the number of laboratories? Here we are lucky, there are already indications in the EPPO standard PM7-122, where 10 participants at least are recommended. What is important that we state is that if there is less participants for a test in the test performance study, you have to explain it clearly. You must have a warning, because the lower the number of participants, the less representative it can be of the overall performance of the test in the population of diagnostic laboratories. So, in conclusion for this introduction, your sample panel needs to be designed efficiently, minimizing the number of samples while addressing correctly the weakness and the performance of the test on a sufficient statistical basis. And we made some recommendation, but one about some flexibility depending on the most important criteria to evaluate. One important element in a sample panel is that you have to include tricky samples. Sample close to the limit of detection, sample difficult to detect whatever the origin, in order to be able to really evaluate the performance of your test. And finally, as already stated in EPPO guidelines, you need to recruit at least 10 laboratories to generate a sufficient amount of data to be able again to extrapolate the calculated performance criteria to the whole population of diagnostic laboratories with a minimal margin of error. What has been explained here and in the next video is detailed in the ValidTest guideline. Indeed, during the ValidTest project, the deliverable 2.1 details these guidelines for the statistical analysis of datasets from the validation studies, including TPS. And these guidelines aim later on to be integrated in EPPO PM7-98 and PM7-122. Thank you for your attention.